weight of what we're going to talk about this morning. I didn't realize it in the first service, actually. I just realized it prior to this service. It was weighing heavily on me. And I thank the worship team for leading us in such a powerful time of focusing our attention on Jesus and taking the weight of those things. If God wants to speak to you this morning, I pray that your hearts will be open, that I would step out of the way, and that you would hear from Jesus. This morning, we're going to take a break from our very great hope series, and we're going to pick up in our series, A Maturing Follower. And just a reminder that series is about what is it, we're trying to interact with the question, what does it look like when Jesus lives in and through a person? And through that series, we've been looking at like timeless practices that are ancient practices that are thousands of years old that we can incorporate into our lives for spiritual formation. And it's interesting, this week, the practice that we're looking at is the practice of reconciliation. And we might not think that, that is a spiritual practice that I need to put into practice, but actually it's one of the most important. And one of the ones that focuses in on what God has done through Jesus Christ and how that we can let that flow out of us into our relationship with one another. There's a well-known poem that goes like this. To live above with the saints we love, oh, that would be glory. But to live below with the saints we know, that's another story. It's kind of a goofy poem. It's kind of funny because it hits at a real pain point in our lives. It hits on the reality that we need to live together. We need to live in a community. And we've gathered a bunch of different people of different socioeconomic, different age groups, even different races, different gender, male and female. And we need to come together and function as one unit. And that is what essentially Paul is calling us to. What Paul is calling us to, he's inviting us, and ultimately God is inviting us into this radically different kind of community and family. Jesus is inviting us to a rule of life of reconciliation. One that sees us not as supreme individuals, people that are seeking our own happiness or our own truth at all costs, but actually to one of a new community, of people who are empowered by the Holy Spirit to live righteous lives with God and with each other, to be in right relationship with God and each other. We're a community marked by peace. And so as we look into Colossians 3, verses 12 to 17, there's a few things that I want to glean from these passages. One, that we're an interdependent community that seeks Jesus and His peace at all costs. And part of that is this radical focus towards reconciliation. As we enter into this passage, the first thing in verse 12 that we see is Paul says, therefore, and then right away he makes an identity statement. He says, therefore, as God's chosen people. As God's chosen people, Paul is saying that we, when we become followers of Jesus, are the chosen people of God. Friends, this is called corporate election. And there are certain things that are bestowed upon us as we enter into the community of faith. There are certain things that God has said, as my chosen people, You are one holy. You're set apart to be devoted to Him. And you're dearly loved, or beloved. Each one of us, as individuals within this community, regardless of our station in life, like regardless of where we stand in this life, we are, and if we trust in Jesus, we're loved and we're holy, set apart to be devoted to Jesus. But there are also responsibilities that come with being God's chosen. And these are explained in those corresponding verses. But before we get there, Paul spends the bulk of the first part of Colossians 3 talking about who we once were. So we'll look at verse 5, Colossians 3. He says, "Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all." After the word therefore, Paul is shifting us in our thinking to what the body ought to be doing. The flow of thought is this: because we have laid aside the old man, that is what we were in Adam, and have put on the new man, what we are in Christ Jesus, both individually and corporately. And because in this new corporate man, old differences no longer matter, but Christ is all and in all, therefore, we should put on the qualities listed in verse 12. So starting off, he says, clothe yourselves. Clothe yourselves in compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Clothe yourselves. Take a new identity around yourself. And out of that comes compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And do you notice the similarities from that of that list from Galatians chapter 5? Let's go there. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. It says, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you'll not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, and drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ have been crucified with the flesh, have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. reality, what Paul is asking is that we clothe ourselves in the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is the one that produces this fruit. The Spirit is the one who makes this stuff happen. This is not something that we can generate on our own, although we can to some extent, but to the fullness of what God has in mind here, we can't do it. The Spirit is the one who does this fruit, who builds this in our lives. All of this fruit is other-focused. It's other-focused. What is humility unless I am humble with someone? What does it matter if I am a compassionate person if I never have to extend compassion? So it's other focused. And like clothes often identify things like group affiliation, like I'm wearing this plaid shirt, so clearly I'm a pastor at this church. Social status, job uniforms. So does the outworking of the Spirit through these attributes identify us as Christ's body. That's what Jesus said. He said, you will know that they are my disciples by what? By their love. Their love outworking. So their love spreading out amongst the community. That's how you'll know that I'm worthy of his disciples. That's how we're identified with Christ's body. Paul then moves on. He says, bear with one another. And that can be translated more like put up with one another. And this is this idea of putting up with things that are like an aggravation or an irritation. Because we're a group of people that are completely different. Not one of us is the same, and sometimes that grates on us, and sometimes we can irritate each other, and we can aggravate each other, and even we can disagree with one another, where we disagree on some very important things to us, doctrinal issues, things about how we practice different things, and Paul is calling us, he's saying, you know what, you need to put up with one another. You need to bear with one another. Because no sin has been committed at this point. This is in a place in relationship where things are irritating, aggravating. It's like a little thing that's, you know, kind of gnawing at the side of you. It's like a burr in your saddle. But he's saying put up with one another. And part of that is being empathetic with one another. Is getting to understand where people are coming from. Feeling the feelings that people are feeling. Why are you so adamant about this one thing? Oh, okay. That helps me to put up with you. Or you with me. And then we have to let that empathy lead us to forgiveness when a grievance has actually occurred. So when sin has occurred, when our relationship between one another has become not right, unrighteous, so that we have become where sin has occurred and has broken something so that we're not in right relationship together, then forgiveness needs to occur. And he says, forgive one another as Christ has forgiven you. That word forgive comes from the root word charis, which means grace. That's what we translate that as grace. So you could say this phrase, you could say, grace one another as God has given grace to you. And we understand grace. We understand that idea of like, I'm not worthy of what you're giving to me, Jesus. Your offer of forgiveness, your offer of grace, your offer of restored relationship, I'm not worthy of that. And that's the same idea that we ought to have with one another. That even though I know you're not worthy of my forgiveness because you wronged me so bad, but I'm going to forgive you. I'm going to extend grace. Because I understand that actually, the grace that God has given me is far greater than what I'm extending to you for this grievance. If someone's wronged you, seek to forgive that person. And then he says, but above all, put on this love and bind this all together. This is this picture of love being this belt coming around the garment, pulling it all together and making it all complete. Love one another is what ought to bind us together. In order for proper unity to take place, there must be all of these virtues with love in and through and around it. But unity is not uniformity, right? Unity is about a bunch of different people being able to reconcile the differences to come together. 2nd thing I want to draw out is from a place of identity, as holy and dearly loved, we let peace rule in our hearts. In verse 15, he says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And this peace is not just a relational peace between the members of the body. This is the peace of Christ. And what does he mean by that? The peace of Christ is this peace in our hearts because of the satisfaction of the Father for the sacrifice of Jesus. That kind of peace. And just to get the context, we can go back to Colossians 1. Starting in verse 15, it says, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. Let's let this peace, that reconciliation, that level, rule in our hearts. The word rule is used here, and it's really the idea of a decision maker. We talk about rule of life, and it's really like the trellis that the vines can grow on, or it's like the rails that keep the train going in the right direction. It's this helper. And so whatever conflict we find ourselves in with people, and we will, whatever conflict we find, let the peace of Christ be the final say. Let the peace of Christ be the determiner on how we're going to act, how we're going to respond, how we're going to move forward in that relationship. Remember that reconciliation we have with God, it doesn't just end in forgiveness. It ends in a right relationship. It ends in reconciliation. It ends in Jesus bringing us back into relationship with him. And this is so perfectly pictured in the story of the prodigal son. And I'll jump into Luke chapter 15. And up until this point, like he starts this parable. He says, this man had two sons. The one son basically said, Dad, I want you to drop dead and give me all my money so I can go party. Dad says, okay. goes off and he parties. He spends off his entire inheritance, finds himself in the pig pen, wants to eat pig food, realizes, I have sunk to the lowest low of my entire life, has an aha moment, goes, I need to get back to my father, but he's not going to take me back because I just basically told him to drop dead and took all his money. And then we pick it up in verse 20. So he, being the son, got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. And the father said, yeah, you're right. Nope. The father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. It's such a beautiful picture of the restoration of relationship that God is extending to us through Jesus Christ. We have this peace of Christ that rules in our hearts, but it is also framed within a relationship with one another. And in our verse, it says, let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts, since, as members of one body, you are called to peace. As members of one body. The outworking of our peace with God through Jesus is manifested in our calling to peace within the body of Christ. That's the outworking of that peace. When someone has grieved us, we're to forgive them. And with our best efforts, be reconciled and at peace with them. Restored back into the relationship. In verse 16, he says, this peacemaking is worked out through letting the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another. So this is the idea of the progression here. Is we understand who we are, holy, dearly loved, that Jesus has completely restored us into relationship. Not just forgiven us, but reconciled us completely into relationship. We've been grieved by someone. We forgive them. And then we bring them into relationship. And then we continue to tell each other about the gospel of Jesus who has done this work so that anytime a grievance comes up, the first thing we do is go to forgiveness and reconciliation. We do that so we teach and admonish one another, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. And we do that with the purpose of keeping the community. You see how that flows? You see how his thought flows? How it's so important to him how we do community. It's so important. In fact, it is so important that it is life and death for people outside of these buildings. Because as we, as a church, as we as one body, if we don't get this right, if we don't get together and figure this stuff out, there goes our witness in the world. If we don't figure this stuff out, we're not equipped to move out to share this good news of reconciliation. We need to live it, folks. We need to have it be inside of our hearts. We need to constantly remind each other of the gospel. And one of the ways that we're reminded of the gospel is through communion. And in a few minutes, we're going to come to the table together. But before we do that, I just want to dive down into the celebration and how reconciliation is a huge part of it. The table reminds us that we're reconciled to God and that He calls the family to peace. Let's look into we'll shift gears a little bit and look into 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So Starting at verse 17, he says, "In the following directives, I have no praise for you. For your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. And so then when you come together, it's not the Lord's supper you eat, for when you're eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers, and as a result, a person remains hungry, and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat in or drink in, or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.' So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. And that is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather to eat, you should all eat together. Anyone who is hungry should eat something at home, so that when you meet together, it will not result in judgment." Some heavy verses, I know. Some very heavy verses. And Paul starts off by rebuking the Corinthians for how they have come together to celebrate the love feast, because communion was tied to a meal in which the body had come together to share it. And Paul noticed a deficit in their community and has much to say about it in verses 17 to 22. He has a lot to say. He rebukes them quite harshly. But the underlying reason is what I want to focus on. So, again, I'll take a deep breath. Graham's not going to scream at me. But what Paul's essentially mad about is the lack of community mindset in the church, the mindset that we are all part of one body, the body of Christ. And there's a lack of that. The heart issue is the divisions based on selfishness and that people are concerned for their own families. So here we have the body, here we have my own family, here's all my attention, and I'm leaving carnage behind me. They'd lost this sense of oneness. They'd lost the important understanding that they are part of community and that Jesus was in the center of that community. And it led to the problem of abusing the poor, dishonoring the body, drunkenness. But those were symptoms of the heart matter that Paul is addressing. So the Corinthians, they're commanded to examine themselves, but they're not commanded to examine themselves to see whether or not they are Christians, or even to see if they have sin in their lives, but to see if they are properly discerning the body of Christ. Examine your heart to see if you are properly discerning the body of Christ. There's likely a double meaning in 11, verse 29, with reference to the body, referring literally to Jesus' physical body and the body of Christ. This double meaning, the corporate body of Christ. And in other words, one who treats fellow believers poorly fails to discern that they are members of Christ's body. So with all that stuff kind of lurking and lingering, and then to come in and take from the body, it's like an affront to the whole table. It's like without disgrace, in that sense, is what Paul is saying. And so one may also fail to discern the significance of Christ's death because by his death he created a people. And therefore, if someone mistreats that and then goes and partakes of the Lord's Supper, we're basically saying, oh, well, we're failing to discern the significance of what Christ has done. So practically speaking, this means that we ought to do our best to seek to restore fellowship. We ought to do our best. And there might be a situation where you need to restore fellowship, and maybe it's kind of impossible at this moment because that person isn't here. What I'm calling you to is posturing your heart, is being open to the Holy Spirit to move in that situation, being open to move beyond just forgiveness, to move towards reconciliation. Community matters to Jesus. It matters so much that when Jesus was in the temple and he was seeing the offerings given, he said in Matthew 5, he said, so then if you bring a gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, go to your brother. Leave the gift at the altar. Go and be reconciled to your brother and then come present your gift. Reconciliation matters to Jesus because his body matters to Jesus. To take communion in a worthy manner means to have a mindset that acknowledges the fact that we are one. Proper conflict management is a part of that. So the one thing I want to challenge you with today is when Jesus gave his life on the cross, he created for himself a people, not just islands, but a community, his body. As we come to the table, we need to examine our lives, our priorities, and our hearts to see if we value his body as much as he does. A couple of on-ramps that we can grab onto. Reflect on the peace that we have with God through Christ. We are brought back into a relationship as sons and daughters. 2, as those who are holy and dearly loved, let's strive for peace in our relationships with one another. And 3, let's build into our lives a rule of life of reconciliation, not letting grievances turn into bitterness, but forgiveness turning into full restoration. As we're going to move to the table, we're going to invite the children to come on in and partake with us. Why? Because we love them. They're important to us. But as we come to the table, I want us to continue in this space. The reality is, there's stuff in our congregation because we're not unique from any other congregation. We're a bunch of people that are trying to follow Jesus together. But there's stuff within our congregation. But see, I believe that God wants to do amazing work in Edmonton. And I believe that God is calling us to revival. And I believe that God wants to see his kingdom expand in this area. But people, we have to get our house in order. We have to get our house in order before we go out into the streets. And so we need to forgive one another. And we need that to be a rule of life within our body. That when people look at Central Baptist Southeast location, they will say, those people forgive each other. Those people have right relationships. They might be a little weird and always wear plaid, but they have right relationships. We need to get our house in order. And so as we come to the table, I just encourage you to stop. And think. And ask Lord, to move in your heart, to put you in a posture of reconciliation, to put you in a posture of forgiveness. It's so important. Lord Jesus, we're open to you. We're open to your Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Lead us. God, you've been so clearly moving within our service this morning, moving hearts because you know that there is a deficit within our congregation that you are addressing. And God, we don't want to be rigid. We want to be pliable. We want to be able for your Holy Spirit to mold us. God, we want to be quick to forgive. We want to be quick to restore relationships. So, Lord, we need your help. We need the fruit of compassion and humility and kindness and gentleness and forbearance. And we need forgiveness. And we need to understand that. And we need that your Holy Spirit to work that fruit out in our lives. Because, Lord, we desire the things you desire, which is your kingdom. We desire to see those plans that you have for us as a body come to fruition. So, Lord, we repent and we submit.